Hi, and welcome to Newsmakers for inside analysis and behind-the-scenes commentary from Santa Barbara's top journalists about the most important news events in our community. I'm Jerry Roberts. Tonight, we look behind these headlines. Santa Barbara's City Council becomes a wholly owned subsidiary of the Democratic Party. The school district takes the first step towards life after the departure of its lame duck superintendent. The Montecito disaster emerges as an issue in the Doss Williams-Laura Capps race as the two candidates for supervisor prepare for a series of high-profile debates. A new conflict surfaces over funds for the homeless and the mentally ill as the governor declares homelessness his top priority. And in our political remix segment, we'll check in on some of the other big 2020 local races. Our panel tonight, Josh Molina, who covers politics and policy for Newshawk. Delaney Smith, staff reporter for the Santa Barbara Independent. Gwyn Lurie, editor-in-chief of the Montecito Journal. And Nick Welsh, executive editor of the Independent. Thank you all for coming. So Josh, as you know, the California Constitution says local elected board should be nonpartisan, but you also point out that in swearing in its two new members, the Santa Barbara City Council, for the first time in 13 years, is made up exclusively of one party, and six of those seven are there in large part because of party efforts. What happened? How did this come to be?
You sure you don't want to start with Nick Welsh? He had a whole three paragraphs.
Yeah, I noticed that. That's why I thought your story should was better analysis.
Well, thanks again, Josh.
You
don't like when I flip the script.
No, I don't. Nor does Mayor Locke.
Okay, are you a mansplaining now? You're doing the mansplaining hand gesture.
So, Josh, how did this come about?
Seven Democrats, Randy Rouse stepped down because of term limits. It is a big tent, okay? They are all not like-minded Democratic Party lockstep Democrats. Six of them are endorsed, but there is some range within that. But it is interesting because we haven't seen this for, I think, 2006 when Dale Francisco was first elected and he sort of broke that up. What does it mean? We don't know, but we're definitely going to lose that sort of moderate to conservative voice that Randy Rouse brought. Randy was a no party preference kind of person, but he definitely was a moderate conservative voice. Now we have seven Democrats, but there is a range. Mike Jordan is not a...
Is he going to be the closest thing to a center-right pro-business voice,
yeah,
or you think?
Yeah,
he will be. He sort of reluctantly worked with the Democratic Party to get that endorsement. It's better to be safe than sorry, but in his natural state, he is very much an independent, sort of moderate type.
He just re-registered as a Democrat for the very first time.
To get the endorsement.
So did Oscar Gutierrez. So.
Oh, okay, yeah, there you go.
Before he saw
Council
the appointment.
Member for life, Oscar Gutierrez, yes. So look, we saw this a little bit last year when the Project Labor Agreement passing, requiring union labor on all public works jobs of $5 million and over. No wallet is safe. What other parts of the Democratic platform can we expect to see adopted by the council?
Well, I mean, housing, big issue. So we're going to see more of an opportunity for them to develop housing downtown. We're talking middle-income housing. That's going to be an issue. Kristen Sneddon is probably going to move a little bit more to the moderate right side. You could see sort of a faction developing.
Well, she's the only one who wasn't endorsed.
Yeah, Kristen
is... The Democratic Party passed her over in favor of whom, Nick?
Jim Scafidi, sorry.
Kristen Sneddon is a Democrat. She did not get the endorsement, but she's sort of a moderate family value, sort of traditionalist at times.
Well, she's a close thing also to a sort of a neighborhood preservationist.
I think what's going to happen there, she's a solid Democrat. She's like as D as you're going to get. The fact that she's the most conservative person on the council sort of changes. What does the conservative mean anymore? I think what she's going to have is more of a sense of moderation in terms of density. That's where it's going to push. And she's also going to insist more on affordability.
The real story, though, is who's going to emerge as the leader on the council. Kathy Murillo's running for assembly, so she's not going to be 100% focused. And even in the past, she's not a natural-born sort of leader. She sort of is very cautious. She thinks about her political future. Megan Harmon is really making an impact in good and bad ways. There are people who say she's super smart, she's intellectual, she's going to be the leader on the council, she's going to drive policy. And there are other people who are saying, oh, you got to watch her, she's overly ambitious, she's going to slide in whatever direction that it takes.
And what do you say, Nick?
We'll see.
Oh, boy, that's
how's
crazy.
That?
Okay, so biggest winner in this, of course, is the public employee unions, which now are going to get everything that they ever imagined, because nobody's going to be against that at all. And how's it going to affect downtown, the State Street thing?
Well, downtown, they're all in sync on that issue. They want to bring housing downtown. They are doing what they can. They're very close to hiring a new economic development director. We're probably going to see that announcement imminently in the next couple of weeks. Been a huge, long national search, 70-something candidates or people applied. That's going to be super, super helpful. Everyone's in sync. They're trying to revive that part of it. Right. Mostly we're going to see personality differences. When you have so many people who are pretty much agree on most of the topics, there's a Sneddon, Harmon, and we're going to see that kind of
So Jason Dominguez is... departure is not going to,
you know, I think
we're
a
not going to lack for
a lot of people at City Hall. The staff, they took a big deep breath when he left the council, right? Because
and I think just to jump in there, I think that the friction on the council is going to be much diminished.
Yeah, I think you're right. The key question, so you, Alejandra Gutierrez, who took Dominguez's place, you said her nickname is A-L-E. So how are we pronouncing A-L-E?
Really, Jerry?
No, well, you didn't have it. You should have put a phonetic in there.
Ollie. Yeah.
Yeah, you didn't have the accent. So, you know, Newshawk, it figures I'm, that you wouldn't.
I'm sorry, Jerry, if you thought it was ale.
Well, you know, let's okay. Punctuation, okay? Delaney, or shall I call you Delaney? So Kerry Matsuoka is out the door a year before his contract is up. And so the board picked the search committee, the school board, for his replacement. And it was something of a surprise because they went for the out-of-town firm.
Yeah.
And also the one that did not emphasize its Latino cred.
Yeah, it was a little surprising, especially because now new president Laura Capps and vice president Jackie Reed both went first. And so in both of them, they went first saying they wanted leadership associates, which was the one that's local.
Right?
Yeah, everyone kind of predicted that that's what they were going to go for. They had a whole slide in their presentation about reaching the Latino population. One of the three representatives spoke Spanish to the Latinos in the meeting, just turned around and I'm actually not quite sure what he said, but that's kind of what everyone was expecting. And then the other three members said, no, we want McPherson. And that was a little bit of a surprise, so much so that President Capps was like, let's go back around and re-talk about this.
Well, it seemed like it was a setup
it
for
did.
A leadership associate, didn't it?
It
I
did.
Mean, like Sean Kerry was on board, I think.
It felt like a setup. I can't conclusively say that it was a setup, but it
James
felt like a
Fentner
setup.
James Fentner conclusively said it was the leader of the Conservative Parents Faction.
Yeah, I did speak with him earlier today, and he said, didn't you think it was a setup? And as speaking to his point of view, when he's normally such a huge critic of the school board, he actually kind of congratulated the school board because he's like, for once, the majority vote actually went, even though it was against what the administration really wanted. So,
when you were the chair of the Montecito Union School District, you got a new superintendent, did
yep.
you?
New,
what? How long
leadership.
Did? That, oh, you did.
Yep.
And were you pleased with their
no.
work? No.
Interesting.
No. Why?
Our rep was the former superintendent.
No.
Of Santa Barbara Schools, and I.
Dave Cash.
Oh, and I felt like wow. it was all the usual suspects, all the people who had studied under him. I really felt, sorry to say, because I liked Dave, I thought it was phoned in. And honestly, we had to roll up our sleeves and just go, this is a plum job. It's one school district that has like enough money. It has as much money as any kid should have to go to elementary school, and it's, you know, well-paid job, and it's an innovative learning environment. This is a plum job, and we called all over the country and tried to find the best superintendent we could have after we turned down every single candidate
they
brought to us.
That's interesting. So that would explain why Sean Kerry was.
That would make a lot more
sense. Cash is in there, yeah. That would make sense. Now who's the new superintendent?
Anthony Rainey. But who's we got it from Hillsboro.
Okay.
And it was one of those things where he said, I guess he was one of the ones they kind of talked to, and then he was sort of the one that was most interesting to us, and he turned it down. He said it wasn't going to come for the interview. And I said, why? And they said, we have no idea. He's not interested in coming. And I knew that he was on the Schools for Sound Finance, which is the lobbying organization that protects and supports basic aid schools. And so our then superintendent, Tammy Murphy, knew him from SF Squared, and I asked Tammy to please call the superintendent and get him, and ask and try to convince him to come for an interview. And she said, he's willing to talk to you on the phone. I spent like 2 hours on the phone with him, and he said, I'd love to come for an interview. And I said, why did you say you didn't? He said, oh, well, I just couldn't get there in July. And I said, but come in August.
They're talking about getting this person to by April, correct?
Oh, yeah. McPherson said they believe they can get it done by April. They had quite a few steps, and they something that was really interesting was that they want to have 15 to 20 different stakeholder group meetings beforehand and ask people in the community what they're looking for as well and make it more of a...
Including the grumpy people.
Yeah, they said they wanted to...
You won't be invited.
Yeah.
I doubt it.
It was a really... It was an interesting perspective. I appreciated it. They wanted to include the naysayers, which would be... people
media.
From Fair Education, apparently, and, you know, James Finkner to be included in on the process and say, what is wrong?
That's different. That's really different than a Kerry Matsuoka,
yeah.
Sean Kerry production.
Yeah.
So will Sean Kerry and Raul Ramirez, the assistant superintendents, be looking for other opportunities, do you think? Or do you think they'll stick around?
I think they'll stick around, yeah. I mean, we'll see, but...
Sean Kerry is going to be the superintendent one day. I mean, she's
not this round.
Not now.
Yeah. But down the road. I mean, she's a lifer.
I just think she's too close to. I mean, she's too closely associated with Kerry. I don't see how that's going to. So there's going to be two and possibly three school board openings this year, or three seats on the board.
Mm-hmm.
Jackie Reed, Wendy Sims Moten, and Laura Capps.
If she loses,
she'll probably run for re-election. But are Wendy and Jackie going to run again, do you think?
I don't think so at all,
because they weren't appointed. They never ran.
Right, yeah, I don't think so. With all of the drama that's happened in the last year and a half, 2 years, people, the community care more now. They show up to meetings. There's going to be people watching who's running, so people can't just slip in the seats as easily, and I don't think it's going to be so easy for them to get reelected.
And real quickly, what was the bizarre comment that Jackie Reed was making about the media?
Yeah.
Was she talking about Josh specifically, do you think?
I think she looked at me when she said
that. Well, we were sitting there. I'm not sure exactly who she was referring to. Yeah, she said that she liked leadership better because leadership had said, oh, we read local news so we know what's going on. And then she made a comment saying, well, I'm glad they have an ear to the local media because their voice is important, but oftentimes their voice gets it wrong. I'm like, interesting.
You wouldn't say anything like that.
Obviously, they haven't read the new Montecito Journal.
Oh, all right. Cheap plug. Okay, here we go. So we have Doss Williams and Laura Capps coming in to Newsmakers TV next week for the first of four debates in the first supervisorial district. But you have got Han Hall at the Music Academy on what, January
27th?
27th?
Monday, 6 p.m.
With 300 people.
We hope.
We got
expect.
Lizzie and JP and Hap. That's going to be our audience. So why do you think it's such a big deal in Montecito? Why are so many people interested in this particular race?
Well, first of all, as you pointed out at our last conversation, or one of our last conversations, I just think it's an interesting race. I mean, a lot of people know both of these candidates. They're both Democrats. They're both very steeped in the Santa Barbara community. I think it's a little surprising to some people that Laura was challenging Doss. So there's a little bit of a rubbernecking kind of like, oh, like just going to be kind of interesting to see what that's like to have them in the same room and talk to each other about these issues, because there's so much flying around in all right. the talk. So I think that's part of it, is the spectacle of it. And part of it is that people really want to try to discern what's the difference. I mean, these are two people who are both, you know, liberal Democrats. They probably would mostly vote the same. So really what you're talking about is personalities. You're talking about, you know, who is the person who members of our community are going to feel the most comfortable with, are going to feel is going to take the most time to really understand what our unique issues are. And
but Montecito, of course, you just had the big commemoration of the second anniversary of the debris flow disaster. And that's got to be on a lot of people's minds, I think, as they think about who is going to represent them. I mean, there's real stuff there. And I, you know, it's always a fine line that a public official walks, I think, with any kind of natural disaster, earthquake, fire, anything. And I just want to play a clip here of Doss and Laura both came out with new ads, TV ads, this week. And I think Doss's was interesting because it was so singularly focused on the debris flow. So, JP, have we got that ad we can show?
Here we go. Our supervisor, Doss Williams, he's always been there when our community faced big challenges.
As we suffered through the Thomas Fire and debris flow, Doss helped assist with the emergency response, and he's been there to help families rebuild.
Thanks to Doss, we evacuated before the mudslide. He saved our lives.
Doss took the lead in improving our emergency response to help make the entire community safer.
I don't know what we'd do without Doss Williams as our supervisor.
Lives.
Well, he might have saved her life. He might have told her you should evacuate.
Well, he told a lot of people they should evacuate, but he told a lot of people not to evacuate, too. I mean, if you could take responsibility
well,
on that end.
Well, Doss didn't run.
Here's my question.
The emergency.
No, but he makes it sound like he did there.
She makes it sound like he did. I'm not okay. defending Doss.
No, my question is, for your readers and the people you talk to in Montecito, does that cut too close to the bone?
I think, look, I talk to a lot of people. This is a tricky race for this community.
It was a yes or no question. It's okay.
I think it cuts too close to the bone for some people. I think some people will accept it. They really like Doss. They've worked with him for a long time. I think some people don't and just take it as an overstep. So I think it can be interpreted many ways depending on how you feel about him personally.
What do you think?
You know, what struck me most is he had a power of the Bucket Brigade there. And I know you're sort of fixated on this woman saying, you know, he saved our lives. I think what that
Peggy
refers
Bianchi.
To, you know, on the Friday before the event, he was part of a big press conference out in Carpinteria that not many people paid much attention to, saying, get the hell out, because this is coming and it's going to be worse than you imagine. So he can say, I said that. But to me, when I watch it, I go, oh, Abe Powell, who is sort of, ascribe to him sort of the Pope of Montecito status. And I thought that was a huge score for Doss.
Mm-hmm. What's your take on the ad?
I would call Abe the Pope of Montecito.
Okay, I'm being a little hyperbolic.
No,
he does walk on water.
It's Gwyn. I think Gwyn's probably. Or Bob Hazard. I don't know. Which one. What's your take on the ad?
I thought they should have edited it out the last 3 seconds. It's like too much of Doss turning and looking. If I were editing, take that out.
That was his favorite part.
I would just end one. But I think it's a campaign, and you have to go to your strengths. And she is, I think I read in your column that she said it. It wasn't scripted for her.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's just within the nature.
But I mean, they're paying for the ad. If they didn't want her to say it,
look, obviously they thought that was a money.
Yeah, what the hell do you think? It's like a political ad. It's a political campaign.
No, I'm saying,
do you think,
given the fact that 23 people died, given the fact that the evacuation orders still remain a huge controversy about who was told and who wasn't, and
Jerry,
who was ordered and who wasn't, how that was given, I think that it's over the line.
I think that this election is not going to be won or lost on a statement like that. I think there's no question that our community is still hurting, that our community is still healing. I think people have strong feelings about whether or not Doss was there enough or in the right way, whether he's made the right choices.
That's a big issue in the campaign.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense to me in the way of Doss is trying to have a campaign that doesn't focus on cannabis, and he can't really focus on education either with Laura kind of taking that over. So resiliency is kind of his in to connect with people, and I think that was his attempt at doing so. So I understand it, although I do think it was a bit much. I mean, aside from the conception, it was one of the deadliest tragedies in this community's like most recent history, so it's kind of...
What were you going to say before you caught yourself from mansplaining?
Yeah.
I was quite aware, yes. The people who hate Doss, it's just going to give them ammunition to hate them more. The people who love Doss are going to be like, see, I mean, he's that kind of guy. I don't think it's going to swing a lot of votes.
You don't think it's going to change anybody's mind?
No. I mean, obviously it plays to that whole thing of, wow, he's trying to take credit for something that he may not have done. But that's what politicians do. I mean, I haven't seen Laura Capps' thing, but I'm sure she's going to take credit for a whole bunch of stuff on the school board that took a whole lot of other people to make happen too. So I'm less offended by that. I sort of think it's, you know, he was the supervisor, he was involved. If Jason Dominguez did that ad, yes, I'd be outraged, but that's not the case.
All right, okay. Moving on, more to come on that one. Where was Doss on the day of the disaster, by the way?
I don't know.
Nick?
There's more to this race.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. A lot more.
So the governor of the state of California has apparently been reading your stuff, because he's now said that homelessness is his number one priority, just so maybe you'll stop. I don't know. Anyway, there's a lot of moving pieces to this. You got Trump versus Gavin, but Daryl Steinberg, who used to be the Senate president, state Senate president, mayor of Sacramento, is now the de facto homeless czar. And he's made a move on a fund of money that was created Prop 63 years ago for mentally ill, for treatment of mentally ill people. And he's trying to steal it, raid it, whatever you want to say, to use for homelessness for housing, basically, which is, among other people, Doss Williams is not very happy about this. What's the story behind that?
So basically the story is that homelessness and housing have become like the two top hot button issues in the state of California right now. And as you know, the governor is talking about amending the state constitution to allow the legislature to punish local governments for not doing enough about homelessness. So what they're talking about is taking what was called the millionaire's tax, passed I think in 2006, Prop 63, which is set aside a big, like $2 billion a year.
And that was Steinberg's deal.
He was one of three co-sponsors of that. He said, okay, here's our kitty for the mentally ill. So now he's a homeless czar, and he goes, guess what? I'm gonna go raid that cookie jar that I created. So he's gonna take that money, and he's gonna use it for, some of it's gonna go to homeless services, about half of it. Some of it's gonna go to youth homeless, and some of it's gonna go to—
What would be the effect on Santa Barbara?
Well, the effect on Santa Barbara, the immediate effect, is $22 million out of the budget for the Department of Behavioral Wellness. Now that $22 million is out of a budget of about $137 million. And so that's a big chunk right there, but that $22 million also is a dollar-for-dollar leverage of another $22 million of Medi-Cal funding.
So it's a third?
So it's a $44 million bump. That's not a bump, that's a push.
That's huge.
That's huge. That's like a third of the budget.
So, okay, so then explain to me the overlap, and there obviously is, between mentally ill, addictive personalities and homelessness.
Right.
I mean, that's a big piece of it. It seems to me that the theory of how you deal with homelessness now is going totally in the housing first direction.
Yeah,
we gotta build something.
Basically right now, it's housing first, and if you're not doing housing first, you don't get any money, you don't get state money, you don't get federal money. And housing first—
Is there any data to support that?
Actually, there's a lot of data, apparently, to support that, and that the results are significantly higher if you get people in the house first and then bombard them
with
treatment.
If you don't have a place to live, your life is self-perpetuating. You can't get a job, you can't get help, you can't even get notices in the mail to tell you what you're eligible for in terms of health care. You can't
appointments, yeah.
Right. I mean, it's
so
you can't take a shower.
But as someone who is obviously from your coverage concerned about treatment of the mentally ill in Santa Barbara County, this is not a good thing.
No, it's a robbing Peter to pay Paul routine. And it's being bitterly fought. There was some, in December, there was a hearing up in Sacramento in some obscure budget committee meeting. And this is December when everybody's preoccupied right. with Christmas and whatnot. 200 people, if not more, showed up, mental health advocates saying, this is, go find another pot of money to raise.
So is it a done deal or not?
It's not a done deal, but it's going to be a lot of pushing and shoving before we find out how it falls.
All right. All right, real quick, a couple other races. What's going on in the, you're covering the assembly race now, are you
yes.
not?
Yeah? Yeah.
So what's new there? What does it look like, Steve Bennett and Kathy stuff?
My prediction is it's going to be Steve Bennett and Kathy. That's what we're
in the
looking.
In the runoff.
What yeah. about the crazy kid, Cole?
Oh, yeah. Would you like me to tell you about Cole?
Oh, yeah. This is the only Republican
in
the
Cole?
Race.
Actually, Cole refused to meet with me,
really?
Although he wanted to meet with Newshawk. But
because they don't take marijuana ads.
And I'm Hawk.
No, well, digging a little deeper, he works for this PR firm. It's not a real PR firm. It's responsible for a lot of other stuff I can't get into, but...
Soviet-based?
No, it's...
Is he a Soviet asset?
Have you heard of 805 Analytics? It's run by his
dad. Oh, yeah.
So it's run by his father, who's also his campaign manager, and he also dropped out of college, so he doesn't really have a job.
So he won't talk to you? He won't talk to the independent.
No, but my point is that on the 805 Analytics website, there is a trashing of the independent on one of the tabs.
Oh, really?
So it made sense to me why he would not talk to me later on.
As the only Republican, though, does he have a chance to finish second in the primary?
I've interviewed Mr. Cole. I think
I thought his first name was Cole.
It's Charles Cole.
Charles Cole. Okay.
Yes, he has a chance. He's going to have to get every Republican to vote for him. Democrats are going to have to split the vote. It's hard for anybody, new candidate, never ran for anything, being young.
Except he's got the arms.
Funding. I mean, that's going to get him votes, but it's going to have to take a lot more than that to get him in the top two.
All right. Jonathan Abboud, has he got a chance to be outpace Kathy?
I don't think so. I think that, you know, Kathy has, to the extent that the machine, however you want to define it, exists in this race. She's got the labor unions behind her. She's got the money behind her. She's got $63,000.
And he's got all the Ivy Democrats, so he's got the young Democrats.
Yeah.
Don't rule him out. He guy hustles. Okay, thanks to Josh Molina, Delaney Smith, Gwyn Lurie, and Nick Welsh. Thank to all of you for watching. Please visit our website, newsmakerswithjr.com, to find my blog post on politics and media in Santa Barbara and beyond. And where you can painlessly sign up for a free email subscription. Should your insomnia be troubling, check out our YouTube channel where you'll find an archive of past shows and interviews. Thanks again to our director, JP Montalvo, to our crew, Dan, Lizzie, Michael, and Ryan. And as always, our senior top-ranking, high-powered, high-energy executive producer, Hap Freund. We'll see you next time on Newsmakers, and we'll see you soon with our special Das Williams, Laura Capps debate. Thanks. Good night.